Thank you, Evangelist Holloway. Praise the Lord, everybody.
Praise the Lord.
I got a feeling everything's gonna be all
in the Lord. The humble shall hear thereof and be glad.
O magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together.
I sought the Lord, and he heard me, and delivered me from all my fears.
They looked unto him, and were lightened, and their faces were not ashamed.
This poor man cried, and the Lord heard him, and saved him out of all his troubles.
The angel of the Lord encampeth round about them that fear him, and delivereth them.
O taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man that trusteth in him.
O fear the Lord, ye his saints, for there is no want to them that fear him.
The young lions do lack and suffer hunger, but they that seek the Lord shall not want any good thing.
Come, ye children, hearken unto me. I will teach you the fear of the Lord.
What a man is he that desires life and loveth many days, that he may see good.
Keep thy tongue from evil and thy lips from speaking guile.
Depart from evil and do good. Seek peace and pursue it.
The eyes of the Lord are upon the righteous, and his ears are open unto their cry.
The face of the Lord is against them that do evil, to cut off the remembrance of them from the earth.
Seventeen.
Yes.
The righteous cry, and the Lord heareth, and delivereth them out of all their troubles.
The Lord is nigh unto them that are of a broken heart, and saveth such as be of a contrite spirit.
Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivereth him out of them all.
He keepeth all his bones, not one of them is broken.
Evil shall slay the wicked, and they that hate the righteous shall be desolate together. The Lord redeemeth the soul of his servants, and none of them that trust in him shall be desolate. Hosea 8. Set the trumpet to thy mouth. He shall come as an eagle against the house of the Lord.
Because
thou hast transgressed my covenant and trespassed against my law.
Israel shall cry unto me, my God, we know thee.
Israel hath cast off the thing that is good. The enemy shall pursue him.
They have set up kings, but not by me. They have made princes, and I knew it not. Of their silver and their gold have they made them idols, that they may be cut off.
Thy calf, O Samaria, hath cast thee off. Mine anger is kindled against them. How long will it be ere they attain to innocency?
For from Israel was it also, the workmen made it. Therefore it is not God, but the calf of Samaria shall be broken in pieces.
For they have sown the wind, and they shall reap the whirlwind, and have no stock. The bud shall yield no meal. So be it yield, the stranger shall swallow it up.
Israel is swallowed up. Now shall they be among the Gentiles as a vessel wherein is no pleasure.
For they are gone up to Assyria, a wild ass alone by himself. Ephraim hath hired lovers.
Yea, though they have hired among the nations, now will I gather them, and they shall sorrow a little for the burden of the king of princes.
Because Ephraim hath made many altars to sin, altars shall be unto him to sin.
I have written to him the great things of my law, but they were counted as a strange thing.
They sacrifice flesh for the sacrifices of mine offerings, and eat it. But the Lord accepted them not. Now will he remember their iniquity and visit their sins. They shall return to Egypt together.
For Israel has forgotten his maker and built his temples, and Judah has multiplied fenced cities. But I will send a fire upon the cities, and it shall devour the palaces thereof.
Heavenly Father, we are grateful unto thee, and thank you for your kindness. We love you, Lord, because you have first loved us. Thanking you for allowing us to see this day and the strength that we enjoy in our bodies, that we're able to go and come. Remember those that are absent from the congregation, that seek to be among your people. Even with me, Sister Thomas, Lord, stretch forth your hand and bless them. Remember Sister Cynthia, Lord, in the name of Jesus, let your blood prevail. Let your glory shine. Help us this night, Lord, as we go into thy word. In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Amen. Glory, glory. Hallelujah.
Since I laid my burden down. Glory, glory, hallelujah, since I laid my heart down.
I feel better,
so much better,
since I laid my heart down. I feel better,
so much better, since I laid my heart down.
Oh, glory, glory. Sunday afternoon, my wife and myself, we went to be with Pastor Eunice Jones and the congregation.
Thank you.
And Elder Richard Schofield preached. He preached a mighty word from the Lord. That's the first time I've heard Richard preach in all the years that I've known him. First time I heard him preach, he and I went to Primerica together, where I did get to know him some. And I got to know, of course, his mother's sister called Schofield from years back. But he had a great testimony of what he went through running from the Lord.
Thank you.
And it's not smart to run from the Lord.
Amen.
I didn't want to preach. I did not want to be in the ministry. It was not my desire, because most young men wanted to be in the ministry because of fame and being known. We didn't know too much about fortune. But the fame of being known and didn't want to be in the Word of God to play with it. If I was going, the Word was of high value to me. And if I'm going to be in it, I want to speak the Word rightly. I want to give right understanding of that which God has given to me.
Thank you, Jesus.
And Pastor Jones, when she got up, she spoke something that really kind of stunned me. She said she asked the Lord to let her preach Jesus.
Thank you,
Jesus. And I said, Lord, have mercy. How rich I am.
Thank you, Jesus.
How rich I am. As I heard Elder Schofield, Richard Schofield, say he was rich. And richness has not to do with the silver and the gold.
Thank you, Jesus.
But it's that which God had given. Richard said he was able to lay down at night and rest.
Mm-hmm.
And that's a lot of riches to be able to lay down.
Amen.
And rest.
Amen.
And certainly, when I began to think, when I heard Sister Pastor Jones said she's asking the Lord to let her one day preach Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
I was so thankful that God had given me what he has given me.
Yes.
And I must ask God for his forgiveness because I haven't pushed it as much as I ought to have pushed it. Because when I went to the last district meeting, I was told that everybody knows that Jesus is God. And I said, oh my goodness. In other words, because you say, I believe Jesus is God, you know Jesus is God. That's not so.
Thank you, Jesus.
That is not so. The nominal churches will tell you Jesus is God.
Mm-hmm.
But they see him as a Trinity.
Thank you, Jesus.
And I don't want to lose that which God has given. Some do not count the knowledge of God to be great in their sight. But that was the one thing that I asked God when he called me to the ministry. I heard my father say it. He said it. He had asked the Lord to let him see Jesus from Genesis to Revelation. And I said in my heart, when he said it, I said, me too.
Amen.
I said it just like that. I didn't go and tell my father. I just said, me too, within my heart.
Yes.
And God understood that I meant what I said. A lot of us think we know what we don't know.
Yeah.
When somebody told me that they knew the Godhead inside and out, I said, it stunned me from the one that said it, for I loved him. And he said, I know the Godhead inside and out. I don't know the Godhead inside and out. I know that which God has permitted me to see.
Yes.
I do not exalt myself to understand all of the
the Godhead, and I'm just that great. We were at convention, and I was talking about how God had showed me who he is. When the brother told me, he says, "You're preaching to the choir, Cliff." I said, "What?" He said, "You're preaching to the choir." And that's when he told me, "I know the Godhead inside and out."
Thank you.
I don't know the Godhead inside and out. I believe with all my heart that Jesus is the beginning and he's the end. And all power in heaven and earth is in his hand.
Thank you.
But to say that I know it inside and out, I cannot say.
Thank you, Jesus.
For I am blessed each time I look and see how God shows me.
Hallelujah.
Just who he is.
Thank you, Jesus.
There's too many that have a surface belief of God. And the apostolic church is lending itself to be as the other churches. That is, what other folks call holiness, the apostolic church now is calling it holiness. And that they're in the church. They do not recognize the difference between us and them. There is us, and there is them. And them try to include themselves with us.
Thank you, Lord.
They have taken our testimony. They have learned our dance.
Yes, yes.
They have learned our praise. So much so that speaking in tongues is gibberish.
Thank you, Lord.
It's just a whole lot of blah, 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 blah. And they call that tongues. But when the Holy Ghost comes, it is specific. And when the Holy Ghost comes, it is distinctive. But when we begin to mesh with the other churches, we pick up their habits. We pick up their type of holiness.
Yes.
And we lose our identity. Until they sound like us, and we begin to sound like them. God knows those that are his. God knows those that are his. I'm happy to see the young people in Bible class tonight.
Thank you, Jesus.
Because if they're going to sing in the choir, I want them in Bible class.
Amen.
They don't want to come to Bible class, they don't have to sing.
Thank you, Jesus.
They don't have to sing. That's up to them. You know, I've tried to entice them in all that I know how, but they're smarter than I am.
Yeah.
So when people are smarter than you, you must leave them alone.
Thank you.
They just have to keep living.
All right.
and then they'll become as dumb as I am. I think it was what's his name there in Cleveland? J.D. Ellis. I forgot how he put it. Is that when he was young, grandma was old and then crazy. But the older he got, the smarter grandma got. And so I was talking to a friend today, and I was told that brother had told him that when it comes time for him to pass away, he's going to ask the Lord to forgive him for what he didn't do. And then the Lord will forgive him, then he'll be able to go to heaven. Now, you might think this is somebody that's living in the street and don't know God, and don't know his word.
Well,
you'd be highly mistaken. This one knows the word. And you won't want to contend with him when it comes to who Jesus is, because they know. But when you get silly and you can play with the devil,
thank you, Lord,
and you can get, you know how to handle God.
Thank you, Jesus.
You know how to get around God,
well,
that you can get into heaven without doing what you're supposed to do. You know, understand me. Ain't none of us going to complete everything that we're supposed to do to get into glory. But don't play God.
Thank you, Lord.
Don't play God. You know, play me. And a lot of folk, they will try to play the pastor. But you got to understand, God knows. God knows exactly what he is doing. But we thank God for this night. Now, I've been up almost half the night trying to go to sleep.
Oh, yes, Lord.
And couldn't get to sleep like I wanted to go to sleep. My feet aching me, and I can't read because I done broke my reading glasses. Now I got to go buy some new glasses. And so I thought I'd do this. I'd make this an open forum Bible class.
Thank you.
If you got some questions, you want to know something, this is your chance to ask a question. Anybody got any question? Now, if you ain't got no question, I'll go ahead on my own. But I thought I'd give you an opportunity to ask questions. Everybody want to ask me a question when I'm in the door and ready to leave.
I have a question. I said I get it. It's in my phone.
Now is your time to ask your question, and we will endeavor to answer it according to the scriptures. Amen. We'll endeavor to answer it according to the scriptures. I'm glad to see my young people in here. Now that the floor is open to the questions, I know nobody can think of a question that they wanted to ask. You got a question, Crystal? Nobody got that question? They'll take it.
I gotta get it out of my phone. I typed it in as I was reading. So,
thank you.
Okay, I think it's Isaiah 19 and 25.
19. This is something you've been reading?
I've read it and had a question about it. I didn't study. I just wrote down, typed in the question as I was reading, so I wouldn't forget. Where it says, I want to know, is this God speaking when he was calling Egypt his people?
Let's see what he has to say here.
Whom the Lord of hosts shall bless, saying, blessed be Egypt, my people, and Assyria, the work of my hands, and Israel, my inheritance.
In other words, all people are God's people.
Okay.
Israel is that those that inherited the word from God. God created all men. And he created, what, I can never pronounce that word, religiosity. It's not, it didn't have T on the end.
Religiosity,
it's a Y on it. No, he's saying that that's not the T-Y.
It didn't have T-Y on it. That's come out in it's this movie with Bill Maher. He made a movie mocking the different religions in the world. You can mock the different religions in the world if you so desire. But you better know what you're doing when you come to the place and you're mocking God's word and God's people. Well, in essence, he did not, Bill Maher, mock God's people. He mocked those who called themselves God's people, who had no knowledge of who God really is. Such is the same thing with the story of God with Morgan Freeman that comes on, and he took and he began to go to the different religions all over the world and looking at them and what they believe and what they don't believe, and he wanted to, of course, whenever they think about looking into Christianity, they always go to Catholicism, and which tells me they don't know what Christianity is. Because Christianity, I mean Catholicism, is not Christianity. It is another idol worshiping religion. They took the name Christian, but in essence, they don't believe Christ. They don't put their trust in Christ. It is they went and applied the faith of Christ to their idols. You all look and see the statue of Mary and a baby. That's Tammuz. That's not Christ, but the Catholics apply the name Mary to Tammuz and built that religion. And in order to entrap the Christian, they named Tammuz Mary. Tammuz is an idol. It's Ezekiel speaks of Tammuz. Look up Tammuz for me, Sister Ashton. I forget what chapter it is, but it's in Ezekiel. If you can't find it, my concordance is in my drawer in the credenza in my office.
Can you spell it?
T-A-M-M-U-N-Z.
M-U-N-Z?
I think it is. I hope I said it right.
T-A-M-M-U-Z.
Yeah, T-A-M-M.
Ezekiel 8:14.
Then he brought me to the door of the gate of the Lord's house, which was toward the north, and behold, there sat women weeping for Tammuz. It's a Greek goddess. That the Catholics have applied the worship of Tammuz to Mary. Tammuz was supposed to have a child without the assistance of a man. And they applied that to being Christ. Y'all never heard that, have you? Y'all heard it? But they have applied that to Christianity. Yes, ma'am.
I say I heard that before because I heard in that book, in the Matthew, the one you gave us.
Matthew 28:19.
They were talking about Mary, how she is in the Catholic Church, but she's really an idol. And
yes.
She has many names.
Right.
She has many names.
And right. I forgot that it is in that book.
That's in that book. That's why I say I've heard that, but not, you know, I've heard that she is portrayed as the mother of Jesus, but she's really not the mother of Jesus. She's portrayed as many different women, goddesses.
Right. It's, in other words, Tammuz is an idol in the Catholic Church. And to make it acceptable in the Christian world, they changed her name to Mary. Do you have a little history on Tammuz, Sister Ashley?
It says in Babylonia, the month Tammuz was established in honor of the eponymous god Tammuz, who originated as
Would you read it again and make it very distinct? You went over a word that I didn't quite understand what you said.
Because I don't even know if I said it right. Eponymous. E-P-O-N-Y-M-O-U-S. Eponymous god Tammuz, who originated as a Sumerian shepherd god.
Yeah.
Dumuzit or Dumuzi, the consort of Inanna, and in his Akkadian form, the parallel consort of Ishtar.
Yes.
That's from Wikipedia.
Yeah, I have dictionary.com for that.
And the Catholics went and changed this and made it Mary. Tammuz and her baby, Mary and Jesus. They pictured it as Mary and Jesus. And we have seen the picture of Mary and Jesus as a little baby. That's Tammuz. These are the things that the Catholics have put into the church, and the church has accepted it. Marvin Arnold wrote a book, anyway, it gives a history of the church and how that the enemy has planted seeds of deception in the church. Where would you find that in scripture that would relate to that? Seeds of deception being planted in the church. I can't. I heard voices, but I don't know what they said.
We said tares in the wheat.
The tares in the wheat. The 13th chapter of Matthew. Let's go to the 13th chapter of Matthew. I'm going to see if we can get the correct.
Yeah, 13 and 36.
Yes, the 24th. I was just looking to make sure.
Oh, yeah.
Start, sister. Read the. Everyone don't have their questions.
Another parable put he forth unto them, saying.
Now, this is a parable that Jesus is putting forth to the people. Julian, sister, Ashley, yes.
I have a question if this is starting your lesson.
Yes.
Okay, I heard a few times over the past two weekends, I guess, and this isn't the first time really, but people were talking about how God called them out of their family and all of that. You've spoken on that before. This time it
God
was...
God called them what?
It, you know, called them to be saved mm-hmm. instead of calling the ones in their family.
Mm-hmm.
Now, every time I hear that, the scripture that comes to mind is, he would that all men be saved.
Yes.
Pastor Urshan brought up that there are some that just cannot do right. Period. There's some just, they can't do right. And there was, you know, you can't come to the Lord unless he draws you. But if you would that all men be saved, isn't he drawing all men?
Yes.
Because he's given everybody, he died for all, so he's given us all the opportunity to be saved. So where is this coming from? That is my real question. Where is this coming from?
Tell him to take a drink, leave your drink outside and pour it out if you're coming in here. You sit down, be quiet, but you have to leave your drink outside.
Thank you, Jesus.
What's that you said now? Say it again. I lost you.
Where is this coming from that only certain ones are drawn, so those ones are going to be saved? Is this the whole predestined message in a softer form, if
yes.
you will?
But the message is going out to the whole world. The message goes out to the whole world. Salvation. Now, the field is the world. The word is the good seed. But the enemy has his seed, which he is going to plant. Now, Sister Hope, would you read the 24th chapter, the 13th chapter, 24th verse of Matthew?
Another parable put he forth unto them, saying.
And this is Jesus putting the parable forth. Read.
The kingdom of heaven is likened unto a man.
The kingdom of heaven is likened unto a man.
Which sowed good seed in
the field. Sowed good seed in the field. Now the field you'll find out is the world. And everybody can get this seed. Everybody can have a part of this good seed. Read.
But while men slept. His enemy came and sowed tares. Among the wheat. And went his way.
The tares are the evil seed. We will get an explanation, because Jesus himself will give an explanation of the parable when we get down toward the end. Read.
But when the blade was sprung up. And brought forth fruit. Then appeared the tares also.
Now, the tares look very similar to the wheat. Now, if the tare and the wheat looked diametrically opposed to each other, that is, they look completely different than each other, would there be any difficulty in separating the tare from the wheat? Mama used to say, go out there and pull those weeds up in the yard, and don't pull my plants up. Okay? Don't pull my plants up. She understood that you could see the difference between that weed and her plant. But there is a plant that looks like a tulip in its beginnings. When it grows and starts to grow, the plant looks like it's a tulip. It's not. But if you know what you're looking for, you won't pull up the tulip. You'll pull up that weed, it looks like a tulip. This is before the tulip blossoms. Okay, it's before the tulip blossom. There's a blade that comes up. It looks like it's a tulip beginning to grow. But actually it's just a weed. Same thing is happening with the tare and the wheat. Read, Sister Hope.
So the servants of the householder came and said unto him. Servants of the householder came and said unto him.
Did you skip the 26th verse?
But when the blade was sprung up. And brought forth fruit. Then appeared the tares also.
So the servants of the householder
came and said unto him,
Sir,
didst not thou sow good seed
in the field?
From whence then hath it tares?
From whence then hath it tares? Now, we know that you planted good seed. How come we got these tares coming up? Read.
To them.
First of all, I'll say this. If you are not a gardener, it becomes difficult to understand what is being said here. How many of y'all have had to pull weeds out of your mama's garden? She told you don't pull her plants up, right? So you had to know the difference between her plants and the weeds. So you got to, here is plants and, we can be weed, plants and weeds here. But you got to know what's weed. Because you pull up mama's plants, you're in trouble.
Yes, sir. Yes. Amen.
You're in trouble. You better know what you're doing if you're going out there and pull those weeds up. But you better be pulling weeds up. Sister Blanda, you got your hand up?
Is it by God to let the tares and the weeds grow together?
We're going to get to that. You're jumping a little bit ahead of me. You're jumping a little bit ahead. That's going to take time, step by step. Then we understand when we get to our conclusion. Yes, ma'am.
But you already read this where it says, but while the men were asleep. Mm-hmm. So the church has gone to sleep. They let these things come in. That's the church. I say that because I was looking at Bishop Larry Gates. And he always had his choir in back of him. And he could be preaching and people be like this. Mm-hmm. They be knocked out. When I read that, I could picture them. He's preaching, but ain't nobody getting with him. Mm-hmm. And things are sneaking in because somebody's asleep. Ain't somebody paying attention.
Y'all thought it was just falling asleep on me, didn't you? Bishop Gates be preaching this hard out, and they be.
It's one in particular. I watch him every time. He goes to sleep back there.
But anyway,
they need to
this is not exactly. This is a. This. All right, y'all gonna listen to me, y'all gonna listen to each other.
Amen.
This is a simplistic way of saying how the enemy worked. Men going to sleep, men not doing that which they ought to do. It's the apostles who were very energetic, for lack of a better word, about preaching the gospel and bringing forth the gospel. And men that brought forth the gospel have fallen asleep. And others have popped up that didn't carry the gospel. They planted this tear. But let's read on. We'll understand better as we go along. Read, Sister Hope.
And he said unto them, an enemy hath done this.
He said, an enemy hath done this.
The servant said unto him, Wilt thou then that we go and gather them up? Gather them up. But he said, Nay. Lest while ye gather up the tares, ye root up also the wheat with them.
You see, mama said go pull the weeds up. You with your dumb self when they pull mama's plants up. Anybody do that? Nobody to admit it. Pull up mama's plants when you ought to have been pulling the weeds up, but you was mad. And pull up mama's plants. Read.
Let both grow together.
He said, let them both grow together.
Until the harvest. And in the time of harvest, I will say to the reapers, Gather ye together.
First the tares.
And bind them in bundles. To burn them.
But gather the wheat into my barn. In other words, he said, leave it alone. Let them grow together. It's too late now. If you try to do it, you're going to mess up. He said, but in the time that I choose, I'm going to give you the word. Let me see. Mustard seed. Let's go to the 36th verse. This is the parable explained.
Then Jesus sent the multitude away. And went into the house. And his disciples came unto him.
Declare unto us
the parable of the tares of the field.
He said, make known to us what you're talking about. Tell us what's going on. Read.
He answered and said unto them.
He that soweth the good seed
is the Son of Man.
That's Jesus.
The field is the world. The good seed are the children of the kingdom. But the tares are the children of the wicked one.
In other words, they're both growing. There's an opportunity for you to pick wheat or to pick the tear. Eternal security is out the door. All you got to do is learn which one is which. Now, if you want to play stupid and just go out there and say, well, I can't tell the difference, I'm just going to pick. Whose fault is that? You see, how can I put it? There are some plants that are poisonous. And if you're in the woods, you better know what you're doing. Then there are some plants that are edible. Yeah, bad. If you want to be a woodsman, it behooves you to know how to pick the right one. Because if you pick the wrong one, it's going to kill you. Now, so it behooves you to learn what you're doing. So everybody has the opportunity, Sister Hope, Sister Ashley Hope, for salvation. It's in the world. But if you don't want to pay attention, you just go out there and eat anything. And call it holiness. Right. Call it, well, ain't this a church?
Right.
This is a church. They read out the same Bible you're reading out. Well, you're picking out of the same yard that I'm picking out of. Mm-hmm. But I pick the good stuff. You pick the bad stuff. Why are you picking the bad stuff? Because you don't want to pay attention. You mad. You just want to get done. So you go do what you want and then you pick up some poisonous, I'll say poison ivory. Mm-hmm. Whose fault did you pick the poison ivy? They told you what the poison ivy was. I could have picked it just as well as you. But I paid attention. You didn't. Whose fault is that? Sister Chapman.
Okay. What happens when you try to give those who are in the world and picking out the tares the good seed and they refuse it? I'm not leaving my church. I grew up in this church. I'm like, well, you're going to go to hell in that church. I mean, they don't want to listen. And I understand them. I was like, well, yeah, I understand that. But you also have to know what the truth is. Right. If they're not giving you the truth, then you need to leave.
Yeah.
And
why are they in the church?
Because they grew up there.
No. No. That's not why they're there.
They're comfortable.
No.
Why?
It allows them to do what they want to do without any recourse. They can say what they want to say, go where they want to go, do what they want to do, and there's no recourse. And they're still in church. They're still in their church. If you come to your church, well, you can't. And I don't want to be restricted. I want to go to heaven, but I don't want to be restricted here on earth. And my church tells me I can do what I want to do and still go to heaven. Why are they still there? They know it's wrong. I need a dog dare you to say one word of profanity among them. What?
That's right.
You ain't saved. You supposed to be so saved. No, I mean, I'm just saying.
Right.
They know. They understand. I'm trying to get you to understand. They have the opportunity, but they don't want that opportunity. They want to stay where they are because they can do what they want to do when they want to do it. And still say, I'm on my way to glory because they get to heaven. Well, Lord, I did what the pastor told me to do. But they don't know the scripture says the blind lead the blind. Sister Pokey, you had your hand up.
Yes, sir. Is that the scripture that says their bands are not as we? That's,
no bands in their death.
Yeah. Right.
Yes.
Right.
There's nothing holding.
There's nothing to hold them back. If you come here, you got certain restrictions. As if I'm putting restrictions on you, chasing you around and seeing what you're doing. I'm going to make sure that you don't do this. How many of y'all seen me outside your door? You ain't seen me out there. So what's holding you back from committing the many sins that are in the world? It's the truth that you know. Yes, ma'am.
Well, whenever I was out there in the world and in the other church, it's like I went there, but just like you said, there was no bands that was holding me back, nothing to tell me that I was doing the right thing or the wrong thing. The preacher's up there preaching whatever it is he wanted to preach, and everybody else is sitting up there listening. I don't think there was too many Bibles that were open like it is here. Mm-hmm. You know, so the pastor can pick stuff off the top of his head and tell them. And if it's not in the Bible, then they ain't got nothing. He can say whatever it is he want to say. And if somebody confront him, first thing he say, well, I didn't say that. You know, because he don't have anything to go by.
Right.
You know, and they're sitting up there sucking it up and just eating it up. You know, like, I know there were some things that I knew that wasn't so, but then whenever it came over the pulpit, I said, I know I got to find me someplace else to go. Because I don't even have nothing to hold me here at this church.
You had some, there was a desire in you to make it to glory, and God saw the desire. And God began to move you in directions to find that truth. You found Early May. Early May picked you up, brought you to Apostolic Church of Jesus, dropped you off and left.
Thank God for that.
Come on, I'm just, but God used her to get to you where you are. Sister, no, Sister Henry.
I remember when me and my sisters used to go to my godparents.
Now, I'm going to tell you something. You all can't speak down low because everybody's trying to listen to hear what you say, and so am I. So if you project it up here so I can hear it, everybody going to hear it.
I remember when I used to go to my godparents' church, and they went to this Baptist church, and like the pastor barely like stood, like he never came up to the mic. Like from what I remember, I never heard him preach for it. I heard him say a few scriptures out the Bible, and maybe, you know, they'll shout a little, but majority of the time it was like singing and praise dancing, and like he was testifying forever. And I used to think, because like we were still going here, but it wasn't as much as we do now. And I used to, like, at the time it looked like wow, but at the same time, as I'm older, I can see that wasn't nowhere near the truth, because he didn't preach. Like, it's like he sat in his seat and nodded his head the whole time, and I was just like, where's the word at? Like,
look, they shouted like we shouted.
They
played the same music we played. And sisters and brothers, while they in church, you didn't hear no profanity while you was inside the church building. But once you got outside,
amen.
Lord have mercy. So they were sanctified in appearance. But when they got away from church, the further they got away from the building, the more they got away from their God. So, you, now they all have the opportunity. The opportunity, Sister Ashley, came to all of them. All of them have received the opportunity for the truth. But why didn't they accept it? It would curtail the way that they live. And they wanted not their living curtailed. There's no bands in their living.
Okay. Can you tell me exactly what that means, no bands?
Nothing restricted them.
Okay. It says in their death, in their Bible. Death. So what is that?
And how does it, that's in the 73 Psalm.
But for me, my feet were almost gone.
No, read.
My steps had well been
smooth. Back up where it says there's no bands.
I'm coming down to it.
Oh.
I was giving you the whole context. For I was envious at the foolish when I saw
the prosperity
of the wicked.
I know what that means.
For there are no bands in their death.
Now, what does it mean, no bands?
Their strength is firm.
No bands in their death. There's no bands to what they can do.
No restrictions.
No restrictions. No restrictions. That's right. They're dealing with the word death.
This is their death.
There's no bands in their death.
Their death. To their death, there's no bands. There's no band. They can do what they want. They're gonna go to heaven anyway. There's no restrictions to their death. There's no restrictions. You can die.
You're
going in anyway.
Okay.
Sister Ashley.
The example that you use with Sister Blannon is similar to some of the examples used to prove the drawing, they can't be saved, they wouldn't have heard unless the Lord drew them. And they say it as though he only draws certain ones.
No, no.
That's my issue with it. They say they only draw certain ones, but no one goes to the scripture that God would that all men be saved.
No, they won't go there. Because that would blow their premise out of the water.
Right.
You know, you avoid that, which destroys what you want to believe.
Right.
And to go that to he would that all men be saved, that destroys that eternal security, or it is only picking certain ones.
Mm-hmm.
God said he would that all men be saved. And that all will come to the knowledge of the truth. Everyone has the ability to receive. All of them are not. Yes, ma'am.
And just going back to what Sister Blandon said, I used to hear him say, my preacher said, my pastor said, never referring to the
scripture.
Bible. Right.
Yeah. Your pastor say, my pastor say.
Right.
Your pastor, well, who's right?
Mm-hmm.
Who's right? Your pastor said, my pastor said. But you don't use the Bible. You don't use the Bible. You use your pastor. My pastor is such a self. He is a powerful preacher. He's recognized all over the world. What is he recognized for? What does it take to be saved? They have no idea.
Thank you, Jesus.
Oh, yeah, believe on the Lord.
Believe in your heart.
Believe in your heart.
Confess with your mouth.
And confess with your mouth.
Yeah,
that one.
Yeah, right. You are saved.
Right. Yeah.
Sister Holloway.
I have a different perspective. Because what if you're teaching someone that knows the truth or talking to somebody that knows the truth and been raised up in the truth? And how do you, they know the truth. And I have that a lot because a lot of my family are baptized in Jesus' name and filled with the Holy Ghost. I'm not just talking about my immediate family, I'm talking about outside of that.
Mm-hmm.
They've been brought up in church and they know.
Right.
How do you talk to them? Because I'll tell them to come, you need to come. And they just, I know.
You leave them alone. You leave them alone. They'll drag you down. You're trying to save them. Look, I keep telling you all when I was in swimming, taking lifeguard. So if you go out there, do not let them grab hold of you. Because if they grab hold of you, it's a death grip. And you cannot get loose. Knock them out and leave them. Or don't get close. If they're reaching out to you, leave them.
After you knock them out,
you can drag them if you knock them out. But if you can't knock them out, leave them. Time is up.
Thank you, Jesus.
Time is up.
Time is up.
Come on, sister.
Amen. That's what happens when you get into stuff. Amen. You're trying to enjoy the Lord. Amen. You don't want to let go. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. The word was good on tonight. Amen.
Amen.
Hope you enjoyed the Bible class as we look across the congregation, even on tonight. Amen. It seems that all has been baptized in Jesus' name, but there may be one on the outside. of the door on tonight, amen, that heard the word and want to be saved. We have water, we have clothing, and we have someone to baptize you in the name of Jesus, for it's the only name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. Amen. Amen. We see that there's none coming. Amen. We're going to ask the deacons to bring the basket. If you